How are POWs protected? Geneva Convention 3 dictates very detailed rules for the treatment of POWs. I will only be able to examine a few of them in this short video. It is crucial that you always keep in mind the fact that Geneva Convention 3 was not designed to punish captured individuals. As stated earlier, POWs are only held in detention for military reasons, to prevent them from participating again in the hostilities. In light of this, Geneva Convention 3 tries to achieve an appropriate balance between two divergent considerations. On the one hand, a humanitarian interest by guaranteeing to combatants human treatment when detained, and on the other hand, a military consideration by neutralizing these individuals who represent a threat to the security of the detaining power. Concretely, this entails, among other things, that firstly, POWs must always be treated humanly and are entitled in all circumstances to the respect of their dignity and honor. Secondly, the detaining power must provide for their maintenance and medical treatment free of charge. Thirdly, no discrimination on grounds of nationality, religious belief, or political opinions is permitted. Some distinction may, however, be made on the basis of military ranks or an age. Fourthly, POWs must be protected against violence, intimidation, insults, and public curiosity. It should be noted in this regard that over the last decade, this rule has been frequently violated by the practice of showing POWs in the media. Fifthly, POWs may not be the object of reprisals. Sixthly, internment must be carried out in appropriate camps. For instance, POWs must not be detained in penitentiaries. As I have just said, they are not being punished and should thus be able to move freely within the detention camp. Moreover, the camp should be located far from combat zones. And lastly, violations of the fundamental rules on POW treatment, for instance, willful killing, torture, or any other inhuman treatments, constitute grave breaches of Geneva Convention 3. We will return to the notion of grave breaches in due course. Let me now emphasize four aspects of the treatment reserved to POWs by Geneva Convention 3. Place of internment. In principle, POWs can be detained in all corners of the world, including, therefore, in the territory of four states. However, according to Article 12 of Geneva Convention 3, prisoner of war may only be transferred by the detaining power to a power which is a party to the convention and after the detaining power has satisfied itself of the willingness and ability of such a transferee power to apply the convention. Moreover, when prisoners of war are transferred under such circumstances, responsibility for the application of the convention rests on the power accepting them while they are in custody. This is in contrast to civilians who cannot be detained in the territory of the detaining power or of third state. Interrogation. This aspect of the regime of detention of POWs is crucial. Indeed, combatants have regularly been captured solely for the purpose of gathering information about the military planning or operations conducted by the power to which they belong, or any other forms of military activities. In principle, questioning POWs is not forbidden, and any type of question may be asked of them. That said, according to Article 17 of Geneva Convention 3, every prisoner of war, when questioned, is bound to give only his surname, first names and rank, date of birth, and army, regimental, personnel or serial number, or failing this, equivalent information. This entails that POWs are never obliged to provide answers to questions that may be detrimental to their army. However, if a POW willfully refuses to furnish information about his identity or military status, or gives incorrect indications, Article 17.2 allows the detaining power lawfully to restrict the special privileges according to that prisoner's rank or status under Geneva Convention 3. Nevertheless, in no case may the fundamental guarantees granted to all POWs be withdrawn. But why must POWs deliver information about their identity and military status? Identifying combatants is necessary to determine whether they are entitled to POW status and to precisely delimit the scope of their rights, which may vary according to their military rank and age. Furthermore, revealing the identity of POWs is important in order that the detaining power be able to establish links with the family and the power to which they belong. I should emphasize in this regard that POWs may never be subject to any form of coercion, neither to compel them to give information requested, nor to sanction them for their possible refusal. Article 17.4 explicitly prohibits torture, threats or insults, and unpleasant or disadvantageous treatment of POWs. Other forms of pressure are allowed as long as they do not result in inhuman treatment or in conduct forbidden by Geneva Convention 3. Escape. This aspect of the detention regime perfectly illustrates the balance that Geneva Convention 3 tries to achieve between military considerations and humanitarian interest. According to Article 92 of Geneva Convention 3, escaping or attempting to escape is not a crime. However, military necessity dictates that the detaining power be authorized to take all necessary measures for preventing escape, for instance, fencing POW camps. That said, according to Article 42 of Geneva Convention 3, the use of weapons against prisoners attempting to escape should constitute an extreme measure, which should be preceded by appropriate warnings. Moreover, recaptured POWs are liable only to disciplinary sanctions provided that no violence against life or limb is committed. Release and repatriation. As we know, internment is designed to prevent combatants from participating in the hostilities. It flows from this basic rule that when active hostilities have ended, as set forth in Article 118 of Geneva Convention 3, or when they are individually unable to participate therein, for instance because they are seriously wounded or sick, as set forth in Article 109 of Geneva Convention 3, POWs shall be released and repatriated without delay. The cessation of active hostilities is usually considered to be a question of fact and is not dependent on the conclusion of an armistice agreement and on the stipulation of a formal peace treaty. However, it only exists where it seems reasonably clear that hostilities will not resume. The obligations of release and repatriation have often been violated and led to unnecessary suffering. Indeed, POWs regularly become bargaining chips in peace negotiations between belligerents. In addition, it happens that POWs do not wish to return to their home states because they fear repatriation, often due to the fact that these states consider them as traitors. However, repatriation is a POW's right, which, according to Article 7 of Geneva Convention 3, cannot be forfeited. Nonetheless, the practice of certain recent armed conflicts has shown that some organizations, such as the ICRC, have been entrusted with the power to interview POWs in order to ascertain whether they wish to return to their country of origin and whether they run the risk of being persecuted in this country.